very first solo exhibition and the debut of the River series, Donald's newest body of work. Donald is joining us from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and by way of New York City, by way of Schenectady, by way of a variety of other places in between. But let me not do too much of the backstory, and without further ado, Donald Martini. Thank you.
First, let me say thank you so much to Mary McGill and to everybody here at the Deal Gallery for having me here. It's really a pleasure to come to Jackson, Wyoming. I've never been here before, and I'm having such a good time. I'm truly impressed by the whole town and by the people I've met here. But so to talk about my work and to introduce my work, the River Series, I suppose I should start by saying that I'm not an abstract expressionist. And to say that, what I mean by that is that I'm not focused on the ego or the subconscious or my personal reaction to the world around me. What I'm trying to do is create an experience for the viewer. It's not about me. In other words, it's about you, the viewer. And I'm trying to orchestrate works that actually inspire an experience for the viewer. It's all about that space in between the viewer and the painting and how much I can activate that space. You know, I recall my very first art history class, the first day, and the very first slide the professor showed, he put this painting up there and he said, he asked the question, what is the basic takeaway? What is the first thing you notice about this painting? And the obvious answer was the shape of the form of the painting, which was a rectangle. You know, the last 600 years or so, paintings have been geometric shapes, either a rectangle or a square, sometimes a tondo. And what the question to ask is, what can the shape or the form of a painting do? And with that traditional rectangle, those rectangles traditionally or historically form a portal that you're looking through to experience the artwork through the portal and in another space. And my goal was different than that. In the 1960s, Frank Stella and Ellsworth Kelly started making shaped canvases. And what that did was that created a dynamic where the works were responding to the space around them. And that interested me very much. I wanted the work to be in front of the portal and in the same space as the viewer, so I rejected the rectangle shape for essentially three reasons. I rejected it because I didn't like the shape. I didn't need it. The rectangle as an object. I wanted to free the gesture. I wanted the figure without the ground. I wanted to be able to make an expression without responding to that shape around it. And thirdly, you know, the best example would be the second generation abstract expressionists, who would create a gesture. They would make this monumental or grand gesture, and then they would fill in the negative space around it. And that took away the integrity and the strength and the energy of the gesture, the original gesture in my mind. So the concept occurred to me to completely abandon the rectangle and make the paintings without that rectangular shape, or to get rid of the ground or the canvas, which was a technical challenge for me. But I wanted to say one more thing about the form, because although Ellsworth Kelly and Frank Stella would create these shaped forms that would relate to the space around them, I wanted to go a step further than that by creating very textural paintings and gestural paintings that also the texture of the painting reaches forward. So it's not just relating to the spaces around it this way, but it's also moving forward, and with color it can move forward and backwards. So that was the first idea I wanted to get across. So that's about form. And then color, I should talk about color. I don't think about color as political or symbolic. In other words, I don't see pink as meaning female or a communist sympathizer. I think about color as a pure emotional, a medium that can evoke emotion. And so what I'm doing is I'm moving a physical, emotional tool and that evokes a feeling in the viewer. And so lastly, I want to talk about the river series in the name. And it's not intuitive, it's a little bit of a complicated story, but bear with me a second, if you will. So all of my paintings relate to art history. I'm an art history nut. I really love looking at paintings throughout history. And I was, as I started this series, I was looking at a painting by Raphael called The School of Athens. Maybe some of you know that painting. And there's a figure in the very front and center of that painting. And I don't know if any of you are philosophy majors, but Heraclides is sitting there contemplating his foot in the front of this painting. And I learned that Raphael actually used for the model for that painting Michelangelo. And Heraclides, by the way, is famous for his saying that everything, universal change, everything is constantly changing. And the reason he was staring at his foot in the painting is because he's famous for saying, you never step in the same river twice. And he's also famous for saying, opposites. He believes that the world is built with opposites. And these were two ideas that I really liked about they related to my work, and I think they also related to Raphael, who painted Michelangelo. They were complete rivals. They hated each other. And yet he put Michelangelo in this honorable position, although he put him there looking very curmudgeon-y. So these paintings have many, many opposites in them. The gestures are informed by movement. Movement is life. When you are moving, you're alive. The opposite is stillness, right? The colors sometimes work with the gestures, but sometimes I make colors that are completely in contrast with the gestures that I'm making. The gestures are essentially capturing my physicality at a specific time. And also, sometimes I, for example, in this painting, I'll work with warm and cool colors where the color that should be visually, perceptually in front, I will put in the back, and the color that should be perceived in the back, I'll put in the front. And it's a Hans Hofmann trick. I recently did a lecture on Hans Hofmann, and what happens is, though you may not consciously be aware of it, it tricks you into not just being a casual viewer of the painting, but hopefully you become a participant, you know, trying to figure out what's going on with the painting. And in my opinion, the paintings become more spiritual that way. That's what Rothko was trying to do with his work. So lastly, I just want to say that I firmly believe that color and form can change the mood, can change your mood. And I believe that if color and form can change your mood, then it can change a person's behavior. And if we can change a person's behavior with art, then I think we have the ability to change the world.